Suspension forks are one of the parts of a mountain bike that can often cause a few headaches, be that from incorrect setup in the first place, perhaps you've not been maintaining your suspension fork, or there could even be a problem that's happened basically that you could learn how to solve it. Now today we've got suspension fork here stripped down, so I can tell you a little bit about how the basics of a suspension fork works so you can understand where those problems come from. Now, first up, let's take a look at what's in front of me here. This is a RockShox Revelation. So this is a fairly mid-range suspension fork, fairly common to see on a lot of bikes. This version is the R model, so it's got the basic damper unit on it. It's a 140mm travel fork, and it's come off a 29-inch wheel bike. Now, I've stripped this down into all of the major parts, and I've got the oil in the cups here, so I can show you that as well. I'm just gonna take you through each component one by one so you can understand how it works, and basically you can use this as a process of elimination to help figure out what goes on with your forks and if you are suffering any issues. So first up, let's have a look at the CSU, or the crown steerer upper. Made of three main parts: the steerer tube, which basically your stem clamps onto, your headset goes onto this, and it goes inside the frame. This is press fitted into the crown itself, and then you have the two upper legs, also known as the stanchion tubes. Now these tubes vary in materials and they vary in length depending on what wheel size you have, 26, 27 and a half or 29. And also they do vary depending on the amount of travel you have. For example, if you have a cross-country fork that only has 80 or 100 millimeters of travel, these could be a lot shorter, which in turn will save weight. Likewise, if you have a downer fork with 200 millimeters of travel, these are gonna be longer because you need to have a longer overlap in order for the fork to be stiff enough to cope with the demands of that type of riding. Now, on the top of the fork, if we look at the crown here, you'll see that there are two threaded inserts on the top here. Now, one of these is for the damper to go inside, and the other one is for the air unit to go inside. We'll look at those in a second. The last thing you need to know about the CSU unit, of course, is the fact you can choose different offsets of this. And this is what manufacturers are starting to spec differently now in order to cope with the fact that people are wanting decreased offset on 29-inch wheel bikes. That's a whole different topic, and it is something that we have covered in Ask GMBN Tech. There's going to be a link to that in the description below this video. So if you want to learn more about that, head down there. So that is the main upper part of the fork. Now let's just take a look at the lower part, also known as the sliders, often referred to as the lower legs. Now, this of course is the bottom of the fork. You see on the back here, you've got a disc brake mount, you've got the axle here that supports the wheel in there. You also have the brake arch, which has a mount for the brake hose to mount to. Now, this part of the fork is equally as important as everything else on here. And you have the seals on here. And basically the seals are made up of a few different parts. There's this part, which is called the garter spring. Then you have the actual wiper seal itself. And then there's a foam ring underneath. Now the foam rings, you impregnate these with oil, a specific type of oil that's just there to lubricate the lower legs and keep the bushes on the inside lubricated. Now the bushes, if you look down into the fork leg, you'll see they are located just underneath those foam rings. The job to the bushes is to allow the upper legs, the CSU, to slide into the lower leg with no hindrance. So we're going to start with the left leg, that's rider's left, which is the air leg. At the top of the fork, you have your air valve. This screws into place, has thread lock around those threads, and there's two different variations depending on the model of fork you have and how old it might be. Now, traditional ones use a spanner to put them into place, and the more modern ones use a cassette tool. Now, this newer version that requires a cassette tool to install is a much more secure fit. You can't slip with it. So it's actually a much better system in operation, and it means there's far less user error, which is a problem if you're using a socket or an open-ended spanner or something like that in order to tweak your forks. Now, if you do have the regular version that doesn't require a cassette tool, I suggest you make sure you have a really good quality flattened socket for this. Now you might notice on the top of this one, there are two gray spacers. These are air volume spacers. Now they're called different names depending on the forks that they're in, whether you've got Fox, RockShox or anything else, but essentially they are air volume spacers. They are there to change the ride quality of the air spring. More spacers means the fork is going to ramp up more. It will feel more progressive. It will feel very supple on the initial part of the stroke, and then it will almost resist bottoming throughout that travel. Less means the opposite of that. It means you're going to use all that travel a lot easier. So depending on how much travel your bike has, how you like to ride, and your preferences, you can tune the way it feels by adding or subtracting those from your air leg. And next up, further down, is the lower part of the air tube or the air spring. So at the top here, you have the air valve, that's where you input the air. And currently at the bottom, there is nothing in there. Now, this is what happens at the bottom end. You have an air tube that goes in there. Air tube has a piston, it has a top out bumper, and it has a lower part that's held in place by a circlip. Basically, it's that simple. Now, something important to know about this is you have the positive air chamber and you have the negative air chamber. Now, on older model forks, that negative air chamber would be a coil spring. And if you wanted to change the progression of the fork, you wouldn't have air volume spaces, you would simply add oil into the air chamber. And what that does is effectively take up the space that these would do, i.e. making the air space smaller. So the air volume reduces. By reducing the air volume, the fork becomes more progressive. Now, with this newer system that you see on most modern air sprung forks, on the inside of the air leg, there's a small dimple. Now, what happens is when you're putting the air into the air valve at the top, you're, depending on the model of fork, the brand of fork you have, you have to depress the fork a few times to allow the air to swap from the positive chamber into the negative, which is this space here. Now, if that does that correctly, the fork will feel very supple because you have that negative spring that is charged, and then of course you have the positive to support your weight. That is how it should be working. And of course, when this is in place in the leg, in fact, I will just demonstrate just by roughly sliding it in. That air tube then has threads in the end that are met with the foot nut on the bottom. Obviously, this goes into the lower leg part of the fork first, and a foot nut will screw into the base of this. Now, when you're doing a lower leg service or you're taking the lowers off the fork in any case, this is why you need to shock these sometimes, because these can stick, both of these rods can stick to the inside of the fork. Now, what the shocking simply does is you would undo the bolt a certain amount of weight and then tap firmly with a soft ended mallet. This could be a wooden mallet, it could be a plastic or a rubber mallet. And the idea of that is just to shock this away from the inside of the fork. Then you can remove this and then basically slide the upper legs out cleanly with this in place. Now, the air tube itself, depending on how long it is, that equates to how much travel the fork can have. Now, on older design forks, these would be notched and they would have a spacer system and different amounts would protrude, but that doesn't work now with the negative air system. So you get different length ones. This is for a 140mm fork and this one is for a 130. As you can see, they're slightly different lengths, but other than that, visually, they are identical. So if you want to change the travel of your fork, this quite often is the piece that you need to change. They don't cost a lot and they're fairly easy to change yourselves. Now I'm gonna make a video on changing exactly that on a fork. In fact, I'll do it on this fork to show you the entire process. We'll do that in another video on GMBN Tech soon. Now for the rider's right leg, so obviously the right leg as you're looking down on the bike when you're on it, you have the compression damper. Now on your bike, you might be familiar with seeing a dial like this. And on this, you have a three position, open, mid and locked. Locked means the fork resists moving under your body weight. Open means it's fully active. Now this is controlled by oil flowing through a series of ports and shims inside this complete unit. Now that is that simple. This is basically just the RL damper, but there are other options available depending on what fork you have. Now this version is very, very simple to do a full service on because there's no additional parts. You just have this which sits in fluid that goes inside the leg, and you have the rebound damping rod that's the bottom part, which we'll get to in a minute. I'm just going to show you the difference between this compression damper and the other type that you often see. Now the other type has the rebound as part of it, and this is compression part, and it's a bladder format. Now it's a self-contained damper, it's all in one. You don't need the oil on the external of the damper, only for lubrication. The oil is on the inside here, and this bladder expands as it compresses, and you can actually see some of the workings on the inside there. Now I also have one of these without the bladder on, just so you can see what goes on the inside. But that's a more complex item that's found on much more expensive forks, just for example, like the RockShox Lyric RC2. Now this is the rebound damper rod. So this sits in the bottom part of the leg there. And on here, you see a series of shims and ports that as the rod extends, basically as the fork compresses and extends, it is pulled through the fluid and it controls the rate of which the fluid goes through those ports and holes. Now on the bottom of the leg, much like the air leg, you have a foot nut, except this one is actually hollow. Now it screws in place just the same, and you have a cap on the bottom which has an Allen key on it that actually goes through that foot nut and into the adjuster itself. Now that is for controlling how many clicks of rebound as you can hear there, that you would like your fork to have. It's that simple. They are the parts of most modern suspension forks. Now, as you'd imagine, amongst different brands, they do vary, but this is the basic layout of all suspension forks on the market. Some are a bit more refined, some have a more advanced damper that's a hole damper that sits within the leg as a cartridge unit, and some have air legs on them that allow you to change the travel of the fork without changing the actual air leg. We saw that on the Cane Creek fork. The only other two things you need to know about them are there's oil inside and how much you need. Now, there's different types of oil and it has a different purpose. Now, in this one, I have the lower leg oil. Now, the job of this is literally just to lubricate those lower legs to make sure the bushes slide over these stanchion tubes and make sure everything stays operating smoothly. Now, it's very different from the damper oil that goes inside the damping leg. Now, depending on the model of fork you have and the damper it has in it, you'll have different viscosities known as oil weights, and you will also have different, like a different amount you will need. It's a very precise amount for different models of fork. So if you're unsure about that, you will have to actually check the manufacturer website for your particular fork and the model year number. RockShox do this by part numbers. Fox do a very similar thing. So it's very easy to identify your particular one against a chart. So there we go. That is the basics of your average suspension fork. Hopefully it's gonna make you understand a little bit about what goes on the inside. If you've got any questions about this one or this video, let us know in the comments below. In the meantime, I'm gonna get scripting and write some detailed fork analysis videos to break some more stuff down to help you understand and maintain these yourselves at home. If you want to know a little bit more about suspension forks and what they do, click up here for our essentials setup series. It tells you about how to use those adjusters, how to set up your sag, how to set up your rebound, all that sort of stuff. And click up here if you want to see the effects doing all this sort of stuff does out on the trail. And that's for some video stuff of me riding with different setups so you can actually see visibly what's going on. As always, if you love GMBN Tech, give us a huge thumbs up and please don't forget to share and subscribe.